moderator is Seth Bongartz, the executive director of Hildeen, the Lincoln Family Home in Manchester. From 1981 to 89, he served as a member of the Vermont House of Representatives and in the state Senate. A native Vermonter, he was born and educated in Manchester, graduating from Burton. He earned his bachelor's degree from Skidmore College and a law degree from Case Western Reserve in Cleveland. He is very active in the community, having served on numerous boards. Anthony Morrow is a ninth generation Vermonter who served for 16 years as editor of Newsday, one of the nation's largest daily newspapers. He graduated from the University of Vermont and received a master's degree from the Columbia University Graduate School of Journalism. His newspaper career began at the Rutland Herald as a teen, and then he went on to work for Newsday, the New York Times, and Newsweek magazine. And Stephen Terry is also a native Vermonter and former managing editor of the Rutland Herald, a resident of Middlebury. He is a vice president of corporate development and external affairs at Green Mountain Power and a co-founder of Worth Mountain Consulting. Mr. Terry is a member of the Governor of Vermont's Council on Economic Advisors and has been very active serving on boards in the state. He also served as a legislative assistant to the late Senator George D. Aiken. Both Mr. Morrow and Mr. Terry are co-authors of the book entitled Philip Hoff, How Red Turned Blue in the Green Mountain State. Thank you, panelists, for being here. And now I will turn things over to Seth Bongartz.
I guess before I start, it's almost have to point out that there was a third author to this book, Sam Hand, who recently passed away. Sam was a revered professor at UVM. Did you both have him?
Yeah.
Yeah, both had him. And he was a friend of all three of ours, and a wonderful guy who was the third author. So we're here tonight to gain historical perspective. Steve and Tony are uniquely positioned to provide that insight for two reasons. Number one is that they were reporters who covered the Hoff era, and we're going to talk about, obviously we're going to talk about that. So they were on the ground as the drama unfolded. Equally important, they are truly native Vermonters who were also living here during that time. And there's a distinction between those two things because they really understand Vermont, and especially Vermont, I understand it still, but they understand Vermont in the 50s and 60s in a way that few people do. I was listed as a native Vermonter. I never say that about myself because I was born here, but I don't have enough generations in the ground yet to qualify. But they do. So they're true native Vermonters, and that's a really important part of what they have to offer tonight. They're here tonight to offer their role as observers and reporters. They are not here to discuss their political views, so we don't want the evening to slip into that. That's not what we're here for tonight. These two are going to talk a little bit about Vermont in the 50s, and then about how Phil Hoff blew the roof off the established order, and perhaps along the way bring a little long-term perspective about the long-term consequences of his doing so. So the 50s and 60s in Vermont were in their own right a very distinct time in Vermont, and it is a totally bygone era now. In many ways, the 50s and 60s were wonderful. There's also ways in which they were not wonderful, poverty and isolation being on the not-so-wonderful side. But let's start with Tony. Let's set the stage. Let's leave politics aside for a second. Let's not leave that part aside. And just try to give people who may not have been here a feel for what Vermont was like. In the 50s and 60s. You know, what did the landscape look like? What was life like? How did people socialize? What did kids do? I mean, by way of example, when I was a kid growing up in Manchester, the highlight of the year was the Lions Club auction. That's not true anymore. But I think you both know what I'm talking about because you grew up with that. And relatively speaking, everybody in town knew everybody. That's not the same. It's not the same in Vermont. And that's, you know, it's got its upsides and its downsides, but it's very different. So I wanted to just start with Tony talking a little bit about what Vermont was really like in the 50s and leading up to the 60s.
Well, you've mentioned all the important things already, except that I will say that if you were a kid, you played outdoors, not indoors. Vermont was a very different place in the 50s and 60s. And the image of Vermont, the way it was seen by people in the rest of the country, was even more different. And I keep being reminded of this every time I think about the Iowa caucuses in 2004 and the television campaign that the Club for Growth launched against Howard Dean, who all of you know was running for president then. I suspect most of you know what the Club for Growth is, but if any of you don't, it's a very conservative group that favors free trade, lower taxes, the end of Medicare, and the deregulation of almost anything. And the ad had a husband and wife who were talking about Dean's proposal to end the Bush administration's tax cuts for the very wealthy. They wrote this down. Howard Dean, the husband said, should take his tax hiking, government expanding, latte drinking, sushi eating, Volvo driving, New York Times reading, at which point his wife interrupted to add, body piercing, Hollywood loving, left wing freak show back to Vermont where it belongs. Now, in point of fact, Iowa has got as many Volvo dealerships as Vermont does. It also has at least 19 sushi restaurants. But as exaggerated as the commercial was, it reflected the reality that Vermont has come to be seen as a place that is on the cutting edge of many social and political issues, a place considered progressive by liberals and dangerously leftist by conservatives. And many, including many younger people here in Vermont, don't realize that this wasn't always the case. As Kevin O'Connor noted in the Rutland Herald earlier this year, Vermont is often stereotyped as the seedbed of socialist Bernie Sanders and counterculture ice cream company Ben and Jerry's. But back before the interstate and the internet, it could be summed up in one word, Republican. That was true. It was not only Republican, but resolutely Republican, and for the most part, conservative Republican. From the very founding of the Republican Party in 1954 until 1962, it had never voted for a Democrat for governor or president. So I'm going to set the stage for talking a little bit about how this came to change by talking about what the state was like, the economy, the demographics, and even the landscape, all of which, as Seth said at the start, were very different. This was a time when Vermont was still seen as the last stand of the Yankees, a place that was small, rural, fiscally conservative, and slow to change and embrace new ideas. People expected their government to be very limited and very frugal. During the 1939 New York World's Fair, George Aiken, who was governor at the time, was on a panel with other New England governors, all of them touting the wonders of their states. He got up and said, "We don't have as much as these others do, but what we do have is paid for it." From the 1890s until 1963, there were more cows than people. Before that, there had been more sheep than people. In Stratton, back before the ski resort opened, it only had 29 residents. It probably had more bears than people. For a long time, the cows have been mostly Jerseys, but that began changing in the 50s, and this is going to be important, when more and more dairy farmers switched to Holsteins. As most of you know, Holsteins are much larger cows and produce more milk. That caused Vermont to produce more milk in the late 60s than it had in the late 1940s, with half as many farms and many fewer cows. The population, which was about 390,000, was largely Protestant and whiter than Sweden. There had been Irish immigrants in the state since the mid-19th century, most of them concentrated only in the urban areas like Burlington, Bennington, and Rutland. Bennington was considered an urban area. There were Italians in Barrie and Rutland where the granite and the marble quarries were. There were French Canadians working in mill towns like Bennington and Winooski, and a large concentration of them working farms in Addison County. What many of the French Canadian farmers did would be called sharecropping in the South. In Vermont, it was called working halves. They would work the farms for absentee owners. In return, they could live in a farmhouse rent-free, could keep half the produce they grew, and keep half the profits from the milk. There are only a half dozen ethnic restaurants of any kind in the entire state. These included the Bowls in Burlington, the Palms in Rutland, both of them Italian restaurants with basic spaghetti and meatballs. The standard fare at most Vermont restaurants was a roast turkey dinner that came with canned peas, mashed potatoes, and cranberry jelly on the side. No one could imagine, as is now the case, a sushi bar in the Bennington Price Chopper. I should add here that in the 50s, there was still a fair amount of bias against these immigrant groups, especially immigrants who are also Catholics or Jews. Back in the 20s, there had been a lot of KKK activity in the state, and it had been aimed almost entirely at Catholics and Jews. There was almost no violence by the Klan in Vermont. It was rather passive, but it was there were rallies in Montpelier, St. Johnsbury, Barrie, Hardwick, Rutland, and elsewhere. And the Klan claimed to have 14,000 members in Lamoille, Chittenden, and Orange, and Washington counties alone. The Klan activity in Rutland, by the way, ended after the Rutland Herald sent a reporter out to a rally and told him to copy down all the license numbers. Then it ran a story saying that if another cross was burned in Rutland County, it was going to print all the license numbers. That ended it there. Ryle Heilberg, the UVM professor, who authored a seminal work on the Holocaust called The Destruction of the European Jews, wrote about this in a memoir he did later. He said he had been reluctant to leave New York for an interview at UVM because he expected to find so much discrimination against Jews that he would never get the job. When I arrived in Burlington, I learned I was safe, he wrote. All the discrimination was against the Catholics. I should note here that at UVM in the late 50s, the school, as a matter of policy and practice, made all freshman Jewish women share rooms with other Jewish women students, and all Catholic women students had to share rooms with other Catholic students. Two things to get back, and then we'll move along quickly to what Seth asked me to do at the start. Two things that had a profound impact on the state were the building of the interstate system, which I'll talk about in a minute, and the requirements by the Massachusetts Health Department, Massachusetts, in 1952 that all milk sold in the Boston milk market, which much of the milk from Vermont was, had to be stored in refrigerated bulk tanks, not the old-fashioned 40-quart milk cans that we all know of that farmers had used for years. This required a significant capital investment that made it much harder, sometimes impossible, for small farms to compete. There had been 33,000 dairy farms in Vermont in 1900, and we could at 11,200 in 1947. By the time Hoff was elected to his second term in 1964, there were only 6,687. And by the time Tom Salmon was elected governor in 1972, there were just 3,982. The dairy farms that remained were larger. As I said earlier, milk production was up by a third. But the disappearance of the 40-quart milk cans and the small farms had resulted in a parallel decline in the Republican base, since most of the farmers had been staunchly Republicans. It also changed the landscape itself. Back when sheep raising was at its height, 80% of all Vermont was cleared. The farms went right up to the tops of the mountains. By the turn of the century, when cattle had replaced sheep, the state was still 60% cleared. It was an attractive patchwork of meadows and fields carved out of surrounding forest. But as farms went out of business and property was bought increasingly by non-farmers, the new owners generally tended to keep up on just a small patch of land around their house and let the fields grow back up into chokecherry and scrub brush. By 1960, only 24% of the state was still open space, and it was a growing concern that steps were needed to preserve this because it was so much a part of the essential beauty of the state that was bringing tourists here. Now, the landscape was further transformed by the interstate, which was built between 1958 in 1965. Before the interstate, travel was very difficult. In large sections of the state, the Northeast Kingdom in particular, were very isolated and very remote. There were sections of the state where people just did not go from one place to another. Francis Colburn, who was an artist, who also taught at UVM and lived in Craftsbury Common, way up in the Northeast Kingdom, in the summer, used to say that for people who lived in the Northeast Kingdom, away is a very real place. Away is somewhere south of Rutland, he said, and no one goes away without first pinning their money inside their underwear. Now getting up to California, Essex, and Orleans is so easy that 2 years ago, Yankee Magazine rated the Northeast Kingdom the third favorite family vacation site in all of New England. So it's been brought right into the mainstream of the state. It was the interstate that made Vermont far more accessible to people from Boston and New York, and thus opened the state for skiers, tourists, businesses, and owners of second homes. The state's population, which had been totally stagnant since the Civil War ended, expanded by 50,000 people in the 60s, which was a huge increase in both numbers and diversity of people. Because there was almost no zoning at all back then, the influence of skiers and tourists and second homeowners threatened the state with a chaotic hodgepodge of developments of being plopped down wherever developers wanted them. And the tourist economy also had resulted in a nightmare of billboards on every main road except the interstate, where they were banned. By the time Hoff was elected governor, the billboards had come to be seen as a major eyesore and were becoming a serious political issue. Now, I'm going to wrap this up very quickly, but I think we have to say that you have to keep in mind that there had been a strong feeling in Vermont for many, many years that, as the saying went, it was a very common saying at the time, a man can do anything he wants with his land. That mentality allowed farmers to throw their dead cows into rivers, allowed lumber mills, granite sheds, tanneries, cheesemakers to dump all kinds of waste and sewage into almost every stream in the state. We have a friend who went to school at St. Francis DeSales Elementary School in Bennington in the 40s. She said the first thing that kids did every day at recess was to run over to the Wallumsack River, which the school boarded on, and see what color it was. That's because the color changed from day to day, from blue to red to yellow to green, depending on what sort of dyes were being used in the woolen mills just upstream. Only 50 of the 246 towns had any local zoning of any sort. There was no statewide zoning regulations, nothing like, you know, Act 250 at all. And there was, in fact, a long-standing opposition to state regulation of anything. One of the first breaks in that pattern started right here in Manchester in 1951. This was when Reed Lefebvre, who was a local legislator, introduced a bill setting safety standards for school buses. This might be seen as something very basic, but there was fierce opposition to Lefebvre's bill in the legislature, where many argued that schools were simply a matter of local control and the state had no business trying to tell any local school district what to do. Lefebvre ran a carnival. It was called King Reed Shows, and he had been a public relations agent for Jack Dempsey when he was the heavyweight champion, so he knew how to drum up support for an issue. He wasn't a bleeding heart liberal by any means, but he was angry that many towns in Bennington County had hired farmers to bus children to school, and some of them were hauling children in the backs of open cattle trucks. It was outrageous, he told me much later. They were hauling those children like cattle in below zero weather and trucks that had manure on the floor. He capped his campaign by arranging for Aldo Maruzzi, who was a photographer at the Rutland Herald, to take a picture of a group of kids being transported in an open cattle truck during a winter storm. And this picture, which was captured the rigors of education in old Vermont, was sent to newspapers all over the country by the Associated Press, and Lefebvre said the embarrassment that it caused many Vermonters got the support he needed to pass the bill, which was one of the first times ever that the state started to do anything to regulate things that had been totally left to the province of the towns. And so, well, to the outside world, Vermont was still Republican, Yankee, frugal. The state was changing in serious ways.
Thanks, Tony. It's and I think just to add to that, for people who haven't weren't here during that period of time, by way of example, the road to Bromley in the 40s, when my father was first here, was dirt, and the road would be cleared. He always talked about after a storm, the truck would come up with a plow on the front and a guy on the back with a shovel putting down. And so the result of that was, in large part, the people from Bonneville, let's say, who had a very distinct accent, didn't come to Manchester, but if anything, once a year for the carnival. And there, it was that isolated in the 40s and 50s and even into the 60s. So just to really wanted to give you a sense of what the starting point is here. Very, very rural state that hadn't changed a hell of a lot until, as we're going to get to in a minute, Phil Hoff blew the doors off the whole thing. But Steve, I thought if you'd like to maybe talk a little bit about Tony's set the stage in terms of what was going on the ground in Vermont outside of politics. Maybe talk a little bit about politics in the 50s. Leading up to, we're not there yet. No, we're not to Phil Hoff yet.
Right.
Leading up to what it was like, you know, the mountain rule, those kinds of things. And just what issues might have been going on.
I will, but let me just say your mentioning of the road to Bonneville. You know, in 1931, the reason we started the state aid to highway system in Vermont is because legislators in Burlington couldn't get to Montpelier because the town of Bolton refused to plow its roads. So that was another, I mean, this was total local control, and it was a religion in Vermont. But let's talk about, and I think Tony set the stage well, in Vermont, you have to, and he mentioned, the Republican Party ruled for more than 100 years. But let's just think about also what was happening in Vermont. Really, there had been really little population growth. So by the Civil War, Vermont lost a lot of its young men, mostly, and it took almost 100 years, not quite, but to change that pattern where we did not have much growth at all. For instance, I was born on the eastern side of the state, Windsor. When my parents drove me to the University of Vermont in the fall of 1960 to enter my freshman year, we were able to drive mostly from Windsor all the way on kind of back roads, but they were then Vermont main roads, and it took close to four and a half hours to drive to Burlington. Williston was a small two-lane road at the right at the edge of the UVM campus. There was the UVM farm, which was kind of odd, but that's the way it was. The politics of Vermont during the time from the First World War to World War II was fairly stable, except for this fact. There was only one dominant party, the Republican Party. But all of the tensions and all of the factions were within the Republican Party. So the person that I had the privilege to work for in his later years of his life was George Aiken. George Aiken was a liberal Republican, almost an extinct species now in this country. And he, as he used to say, when you've got good enemies, hang on to them. Who were his enemies? They were the banks, the utilities, the private utilities. He liked the rural electric cooperatives. They were big business. And he, his allies were farmers and labor. And he formed a coalition that helped him start to change Vermont. Remember, he was elected to two terms as a governor. He went through a marble strike, a granite strike, a milk strike in Vermont, which were just another symptom that people were, or working people, were beginning to organize and beginning to feel the unrest that change brought. Then we have World War II. After World War II, an amazing thing happens. A gentleman from Brattleboro, Ernest Gibson, whose father was a United States senator, who died in office. George Aiken and Ernest Gibson were fast friends, and they formed what is had been known then as the Aiken-Gibson wing of the Republican Party. Aiken names Gibson to the vacant Senate seat. There was no arrangement made, but it was quite clear to Aiken, I'm sure, that his friend Ernest Gibson would not run for re-election in his own right. And when the World War II came, Ernest Gibson went off to World War II. He was a hero in the war. We talk about him a bit in the book. Then he comes back to Vermont in 1946 as a eager, let's get something done. Post-war, Vermont needs to change, and he defeats a sitting governor in a Vermont primary, Mortimer Proctor, 1946. Now, the Proctor family is known in this state historically. Proctor Marble, it had what, Tony, three governors in its
four,
yeah, in its span of its family, and they were the symbols of what George Aiken used to talk about. So Ernest Gibson is a real liberal, and he pushes strong for, in effect, a state power authority. He pushes for, and he carries the Aiken banner of regulating toughly the private utilities. He's really on a roll, and then his friend, who he had met while they were both senators, a man named Harry Truman, becomes president. And as Drew Pearson used to say, Gibson and Truman had a bourbon affinity. Well, it's true. And there becomes a vacant federal judgeship in Vermont. And most usually, the what is then the skeleton of the machinery of the Vermont Democratic Party would expect to have its person nominated for that job. But no, Truman surprises people and names Gibson a federal judge. And that means another 10 years in Vermont during the 1950s where we have basically caretaker government. So here we are, but things are beginning to change. In 1952, a young lawyer from Burlington, Robert Laro, wins the Democratic nomination, and as we point out in the book from a friend of ours who has since deceased, a former journalist, he never even went to the Democratic convention because, you know, that's not really big news, and they would nominate somebody or expect he would be nominated, but nothing would happen. Well, Laro decides he's going to campaign and find out about Vermont, and he campaigns this state. And he's running against Lee Emerson, another sort of caretaker Republican. But he gets 60,000 votes. And the 2 years before, the Democratic candidate only had 40,000 votes.
No, 20,000.
20, thank you. 20,000. And, oh, that's right. That's right. And, my gosh, things are beginning to happen. It's about, and I just... we'll come back to this, but it's about the time Phil Hoff moves to Vermont, and we'll come back up to that. But it is clear there is change in the wind. And by 1958, a Democrat, Bernard Leddy, another Burlington lawyer, runs, and he almost beats Robert Stafford, who is then from Rutland, but he is then lieutenant governor of the state. And the election goes to a recount, although Leddy didn't really want it to go to a recount because I guess he didn't want to win.
He was afraid he was going to win.
Yeah, he was afraid. And it turned out, I think the vote was 790. 790 votes. My gosh, he's almost elected. So here we are, 1960, and the Democratic Party begins to understand there is a strategy that it can win, but it's, we believe, and we've talked to enough people, that the key was to run a candidate who was not Catholic. Run a Democrat who could appeal to Republicans. And Phil Hoff was that kind of candidate. They were able, the party elders in the Democratic Party, mostly Leddy and Laro, went to the person from Winooski, who was the candidate in 1960, a gentleman by the name of Russ Niquette, who wanted to run again.
For the House, now you're talking about for the legislature.
Well, no, this was for governor,
okay.
Again in 1962. Okay. And they told Niquette if he announced, they would oppose him. So that stopped him. And then that opened up the way for Hoff to be a candidate.
Okay. So still putting off for a second what happens when Phil Hoff comes on the scene. Can one of you give a feel for, I know you were both in the legislature, covered the legislature a little bit after 1960, you know, 65 or whatever, but just talk a little bit to give some feel for what it was like on the House floor. You know, who was in the legislature?
Right.
What was it like when you walked down an aisle in the legislature? Who did you see? What did it feel like?
Go ahead, you start, Tony.
Well, keep in mind, it was a very large legislature. There was one representative from every town, and only one from every town, which meant that every town had one vote, and it meant that when Phil Hoff first went there in 1960, his vote for the more than 30,000 people in Burlington could be offset by that of Edith Eddy from Stratton, who, as I said, represented 24. The legislature was much older than it is today. The average age was something like 68. I mean, it was quite old. The average age wasn't 68, but there were far more people over 60 than there were under. There were many farmers in there. The legislature had one section of it that was known as Sleepy Hollow, because anybody up in the balcony can look down in the afternoon, and I'll admit the place tended to be warm, and you can see a half dozen people, you know, you're mostly old farmers with their, you know, nodding off through the afternoon routine. It was a place that basically did what the committee chairs told them to. It was a place that was resolutely determined to keep most control of everything in the hands of the towns. The state had 246 education commissioners. It had 246 highway superintendents. It was a place, occasionally there are people like Reed LaFave, who I mentioned before, who could be articulate, poised, and witty on the floor, but it wasn't a place where you had an awful lot of spirited debate most of the time. That changed quickly in the 60s, I think. But it was, I would say, quiet.
It was that, but it was also this. You could walk in the House chamber. There were spittoons.
Oh, yeah.
They were used by some still. There weren't many lawyers at all, and there weren't many women, although there are a few. And most of the afternoons was spent out in an antechamber called the card room, because they would sit around playing cards. And the legislature was rather a sleepy place because, and this is where we will then talk about a little bit what Hoff brought, but before that, there wasn't much to do. In 1965, when Tony and I worked for the first time with each other in the State House, that was the year the House reapportioned. And by actual count, I know because I did it, they spent more hours really talking about whether town clerks should be reimbursed 50 cents for a dead hedgehog or 25 cents. And that debate went on and on through at different iterations in 1965, which was the very important year that the legislature reapportioned.
Okay, so let's now set up 1960. Let's talk a little bit about Ray Kieser. And how he got elected in 1960. A, that, because he was the youngest governor I think Vermont still ever had, right?
Right.
And then how he got into trouble. What was going on then?
Sure, I'll have Tony start, okay. But he's also, at the time he left, the youngest elder statesman.
Ray Kieser was a young man who, according to Gary Buckley, who we'll come back to later, was the oldest young man he ever met. He actually was athletic. He played basketball for a semi-pro team called the Thunder Road All-Stars. But he was a very quiet, conservative person. His father had been a law partner of Dean Davis. And by this point, what had been the Proctor wing of the party built around the Proctors and the Vermont Marble Company was really becoming built around Dean Davis and National Life Insurance Company, and he had the support of people there. But Kieser, frankly, lucked out in two ways. There was a Republican primary, and the expectation was that Bob Babcock, who was the lieutenant governor at the time, would win the Republican primary. It turned out that Kieser won the primary with only a 30% of the vote. I mean, it was a very small option. And one of the reasons was that there was an open primary, of course, but Democrats could vote in the Republican primary, and Babcock was a liberal Republican, and he expected to get much support from Democrats who would rather vote in the Republican primary because they thought they had a better chance of getting a candidate elected there. What happened that year, for the first time in many, many years, there was a Democratic primary in Chittenden County for a judgeship. And Babcock, who lived in Chittenden County and who had expected to get a, you know, a substantial number of crossover votes from Democrats in a primary, got very few because the Democrats voted in their own primary. At the same time, Luke Crisp from Brattleboro, who had run in the primary the year before, was talking about running again. And Crisp, Crisp admitted at the time that in the campaign the year before, 2 years before, he had had a drinking problem. And it showed up on the campaign trail several times, having drunk too much. Babcock went down to Brattleboro to try to talk him out of running, and probably made the mistake of telling him that if he ran again, he'd have the same problem all over again. And Chris told him, you know, I hadn't made up my mind if I was going to run or not, but you made it up for me today. So Chris drew votes away from Babcock, and the votes that Babcock expected to get from the Democrats in Chittenden County, he didn't get. And so F. Ray Keezer ended up with the Republican nomination. And Steve can tell you about the immediate problems he ran into very quickly in the legislature.
So he's from the holdover wing of the, yeah, the Proctor side of it.
Yes,
the
that's right.
Yeah, okay.
So F. Ray Keezer is elected. Also a young lawyer in Burlington, young Democrat, 1960, Phil Hoff is elected to the Vermont House. But let's talk about, so Hoff in his first and only House term really galvanizes around him some like-minded people. They weren't all Democrats, they weren't all Republicans, but they had a activist view of what government was. And they would hold, and they were called the Young Turks. And they would meet during the legislature in the afternoons, and the rule was they had to talk at least an hour on pending issues or ideas, and then they could enjoy their evening cocktails, of which they enjoyed many, many over the years, as did Hoff himself. However, Hoff decides very quickly that he wants to run for governor in 1962. We have talked about how the party elders kept out the Catholic Democrats. So Hoff announces really early in February 1962 that he is going to run. He has no campaign organization. He has no money. But he has a very wonderful, energetic wife who's been a terrific partner with him all these years. And together, they get in a car and they travel around Vermont and they hold what was known at the time as coffee clatches. And they would go into individual people's homes with maybe two, three, four people, and they would just keep doing that. As time went on, through the efforts of a gentleman in Cuttingsville named Jack Spencer, who put some money up, and they hired a journalist named Phil Savory, who would basically stay in Montpelier and write press releases about what was happening or what Hoff was going to say. There was no media coverage of the campaign, hardly. There was not really any strong statewide television then. So this was a word of mouth campaign that perhaps Ray Keezer and his party didn't really pay much attention to. The problem was Keyser was embroiled in his own battles in the Vermont legislature. First of all, there was a reapportionment of the state Senate the year before, and Keyser favored taking the senator from Rutland County and adding it to Chittenden County. This angered a very powerful senator, Republican named Asa Bloomer, who became very, very anti-Keyser. Keyser also thought that we had too many state colleges. And the one that he picked out to basically abolish was the one in the Northeast Kingdom, which is Linden State College. And that earned him the strong opposition of another powerful Republican in the Northeast Kingdom named W. Arthur Simpson. So there were these seeds, and Hoff built on that, and I'll yield to Tony to talk about maybe one of the major issues in the campaign.
As Steve said, there are a number of things going on, in addition to the fact that Keyser was becoming an unpopular governor, although that had never prevented Republicans from winning in the past. One was that 1962 was going to be an off-year election. And the pattern in Vermont for many years had been that the same number of Democrats voted in presidential years and non-presidential years. But for Republicans, many of them stayed home in non-presidential years. And there was an expectation that there was going to be a lower Republican turnout, especially if they didn't run a serious candidate against George Aiken, because they wanted to keep Aiken down in Washington, which turned out to be the case. In fact, there were 40,000 fewer votes cast in 62 than there had been in 60, and 75% of those were Republicans who stayed home. The second thing was that the popularity of the John Kennedy presidency was at its height. The nation was caught up in a feeling of change and excitement, you know, and government can do things. Hoff was seen as a Kennedy-type politician, and he didn't do anything, you know, to discourage the comparison. And as Steve said, there was, and it was a real decision, to go with Hoff, who was an Episcopalian, rather than another Catholic, which all the Democratic candidates had been for many, many years. But probably the most important thing was the creation of the Vermont Independent Party by Luke Crist of Brattleboro, who I mentioned before, and T. Gary Buckley of Bennington. Both of them were Republicans. This wasn't a real party, and it had less to do with politics than it did with horse racing. What had happened was the legislature had the year before had authorized the establishment of a pari-mutuel racetrack in Pownal. And there was different groups were lobbying to get the franchise to run it. Chris and Buckley were the heads of one of the groups. And they went to Keyser and they said, you have to give this to a Vermont group. Doesn't have to be us, but if you give it to an outer stater, we're going to campaign against you and stop you from being reelected. Keyser gave the franchise to a Massachusetts group, and as Gary told us for this book, when you make a threat like that, you got to keep it. So they created the Vermont Independent Party and named Hoff as their candidate, which was very important because what it did was it allowed people to vote for a Democrat without voting on the Democratic ticket. A lot of people who are progressive Republicans still couldn't bring themselves to vote the Democratic ticket. I'd like to read you just a tiny bit here from the book. Gary Buckley didn't think highly of Keyser to begin with. He was a perfectly nice guy. He had a wonderful wife. He wasn't dishonest. He wasn't a hypocrite, he said, but he was a typical post-Civil War Vermont Republican, very conservative, very prim and proper, and he acted like an old man. As for Hoff, who we had known casually back when Hoff had been at school at Williams, he was a wonderful guy. He was right for the times. But we weren't altruistically supporting him. There was a negative support against Keyser. And we got Hoff the votes that caused him to win. If we hadn't done that, he would have been a perfectly nice guy also ran like Bob Lero and Frank Brannan. When the ballots were counted, Keyser had 60,035 votes on the Republican line, which is the only line he was listed on, while Hoff trailed with 56,196 on the Democratic line. But in addition to his Democratic vote, Hoff received over 3,200 votes from the Vermont Independent Party and just short of 1,900 votes on an independent Democratic line, giving him 50.6% of the vote. It was a 1,348 vote edge.
And with that, it will. So Hoff, in the last night of the the night before the election, Democrats in Vermont have had a tradition. They have a rally in Winooski, arguably then and still now, Vermont's most Democratic place. And Hoff promised that if he won, he would come back to Winooski. Tony and I were both students at UVM. And we both walked to, not with each other, but we both walked from the UVM campus across the bridge into Winooski, and we saw this big rally and torchlight parade. I was on the street, and I'll let Tony tell you what he was doing.
I ended up in the back of Hoff's car. I don't know how, but there was no state troopers. There was nothing. And we got the car. We drove around. But I will, as Steve said, Hoff had promised to go back to Winooski. And I will read you just a paragraph or two from what happened. And so, at about 1 a.m., Hoff returned to Winooski. A crowd of about 300 townspeople and college students had rushed to the city's main street, where a single policeman was trying frantically, hopelessly, to keep them out of the road. I should also say that people in bars were handing out all sorts of free beer just being passed all over the streets, which is another reason I was there. When Hoff arrived, standing in the front of an open convertible, he immediately was surrounded by the shouting, shoving, arm-raving crowd. Those at the rear could only catch glimpses of him in the flashes of portable television lights and still camera flash guns. His sandy hair was tumbled in disarray down over his forehead. He kept waving his arms over his head at a victory sign. Someone pushed through the crowd and managed to shove a tinfoil crown on his head. It had King of Winooski written on the front of it. For a moment, a sheepish grin came over Hoff's face, as though the royal ritual was too much even for Winooski. But he quickly slipped back into the spirit of things, and when the reporter managed to get a microphone near him, he grabbed it and shouted with mock gusto, 100 years of bondage broken, 100 years of bondage broken.
So that's how Phil Hoff became for the first Democratic governor elected in Vermont in 109 years. Well, of course, this was huge news all over the U.S., and he gets immediately invited to the White House, Joan, his wife, and Governor Hoff to meet with President Kennedy. And he is, there's a lot of stories written about him and a lot of people wondering what happened in Vermont. Remember, in 1936, there are only two states in the United States that voted for Alf Landon against FDR, Vermont and Maine. So we were in that era where people thought of Vermont, not now as it is now, but as a very Republican state. Do you want to lead us to our next round, or how do you want to?
I guess one thing we should quickly touch on, I realize we're actually running out of time and want to have some questions, and I'd let this, just a minute about the Young Turks, because they actually, I think what's interesting about the Young Turks that Phil was a part of was this group of younger legislators many of whom actually went on to carve out their own rule, in government. And this was a really bright group of progressives who began to change the legislature as well. It ended up in Phil Ryan, but maybe let's leave that at that. Dick Mallory being, the key person in that. So let's talk, whichever one of you wants to do it. Really, I think you will say that the first 4 years of Hoff's governorship were the magic years. And then so let's talk about those 4 years and what happened. What got accomplished during those 4 years?
One more thing you need to say about the Young Turks, as they were called, was they were, as a group, they were bipartisan in ways that's hard to believe today. Second is they were much, much better educated than the legislature as a whole. They had graduated from Harvard, Yale, Amherst, Williams, Dartmouth. One of them, William Smith Capano, from Columbia, Oxford, the University of Florence. They had all but two had been in the service, too. They had seen a lot of combat, you know, and they were ready to get on with their lives, and they thought the state should get along with, you know, its life, too, that they were... They were risk takers. They were not adverse to taking risk. And this is important because Hoff never had a legislative majority, never came close to it. Hoff set out to reapportion the legislature, to reorganize state government. Keep in mind back then that every agency in the state was run by a Republican when he came in. Hoff used to say, I'm the only Democrat in my administration. Every single agency, and there were something like 126 of them, and they had separate boards that they reported to, not to the governor itself. So, well, most executives running top companies seldom had more than 7 or 8 people, you know, reporting directly to them. The governor of Vermont, with virtually no staff at all, had 126 different, you know, commissions, agencies, you know, that he had to deal with, and they were separating him from his department heads. So he set about to reorganize government, reapportion the legislature, bring about much regionalization. He never got the education regionalization that he wanted, but started the process of it. And at the same time, managed to bring 90 different federal projects into the state, from water resources to highways and education, managed to increase the education budget from something like $5 million to $15 million a year, eliminated the poll tax as a voting requirement, eliminated the death penalty in many cases, eliminated the 246 overseers of the poor, which administered, you know, in different towns in radically different ways depending on who the individual was, and created a Department of Social Services, you know, for the first time. It was just one piece of legislation after another, and it was done with the sort of Young Turk bipartisan working together that it's almost impossible, you know, to imagine, you know, happening right now. Do you want to?
Yeah, I think it was. Remember, Vermont was under a federal court order that it had to reapportion. In 1965. So what Hoff did, working with then the Speaker of the House, Bill Billings, and Dick Mallory and others, they put together a group that made this happen. And it was a long, torturous, it took 6 months. But when that happened, Vermont really started to change fast, and they did. Especially in Hoff's second term, that was probably his most productive term. Actually, the first year he was in office, he found everything so bereft that he entered his office, and there was not one piece of paper in the governor's files. No budget, nothing. So he actually took his first year and created a planning year. And this caused all kinds of controversy, but out of it came a lot of these ideas that were really played out for the next 3 or 4 years of the Hoff being in office. The clearly reapportionment was an important thing because it then helped bring Vermont really into the 20th century. And it, go ahead, and
20th century's fine.
20th century. But it was the catalyst, and I think that's what, when we think of Phil Hoff, it is a catalyst for change. And he pushed Vermont really hard, and as we point out in the book, in his last term, perhaps more than Vermont was willing to go.
But the only thing I was going to add there was that there were a number of reapportionment plans, one which would have cut the House from 246 to 215, another to cut it to 150, which is what Hoff wanted. When it got cut to 150, it was mostly the farmers who went away. And they were the ones who had resisted almost every attempt to change anything. And during the end of his second term, when legislation was just flying out of the place over and over, Emory Hebbard, who was a very conservative a Republican from Glover, he complained about all the legislation that was going through, and he said, all those farm boys used to vote no, they aren't here anymore.
And that was, just think, so the House reapportions in 65. Under the court order, there had to be a special election in the fall of 65 to seat a new legislature, 150 members in the House. And that legislature in 1966 met from January, adjourned March 12th, 1966, and it created what we know, or I guess it did the year before, the legislative council, but that started to get legislators with some staff help. We almost passed a law that allowed the state of Vermont to pre-buy power from Canada. That was a big dream of Phil Hoff in the 1966, but the legislation got finally killed. And this is one of the things that Phil Hoff, I think, even now at age 88, and he's getting frail these days, but this is a topic that can still bring passion in his voice, that he lost that.
So let's just do one more quick, and then we'll go to questions. This could go on, because there's actually be interesting to go on beyond the Hoff years and the implications. But talk a little bit, one of you, just about Hoff's last term, where he got into some political trouble, and what are the two or three things that led to that?
Well, let me start with that because I was here then, and what happened is that Hoff got very much involved in concerned about the Vietnam War. He was in the 1965, early 66. He was a supporter at the moment of Lyndon Johnson. Then by 1968, he becomes, along with most or many other Vermonters, disenchanted with the war. He becomes the first Democratic governor in February of 1968. He has a formal break with Lyndon Johnson. This is before Johnson announces he will not seek another term, and he announces his support for Bobby Kennedy. That and issues of race and justice becomes a real preoccupation for Governor Hoff. He started after the race riots in 1968, he starts with Mayor John Lindsay of New York, a special program in Vermont called the Vermont New York Youth Project, which brought young black urban blacks to Vermont with Vermont white kids, and they had they did a lot of arts and crafts, and they did theater, and they just tried to know how it was to get along with each other. But frankly, it sparked an ugly chapter of racism in this state that is still, thinking back on it, it's still, even though I've been here all my life, it's somewhat shocking even now to think about it. And we had in the town of Irisburg, 1968, a racial incident in which a black minister's house was shotgun at night, and it was all this turmoil that was beginning to happen in the state. Clearly, Phil Hoff was losing his touch on the average Democrat and many people in the state.
Classic political mistake of getting too far ahead.
Well, that's what he said afterwards. Yeah. That in terms of the war, his core constituency included a lot of blue-collar Democrats who still supported the war at the time, and they also were afraid that Hoff was not just trying to bring in black students for a summer program, but to bring in blacks from the cities who would take their jobs. And it became ugly. He lost a lot of his support, and as he said, you know, when he lost at his race for the Senate 2 years later, when you get too far ahead of your constituency, you're out of there, and that's what happened to me.
So, we went on a little longer than we anticipated, but we still have some time for questions. So, any questions?
Yeah, what was the reason for the court order for the reapportionment?
Well, there was a federal there was a federal court case, and there was a earlier Supreme Court ruling that's that states were not properly
one person, one vote.
One person, one vote. Yeah, thank you.
Let me just say, actually, I should have mentioned it before. I mentioned the Vermont Independent Party. The Vermont Independent Party said if they're going to have a party, they ought to have a platform. So the only plank in their platform was to bring about reapportionment and to file a suit for reapportionment against Hoff, although Hoff's law firm did most of the actual work on it. So Gary Buckley says we're the only party in history that kept all its promises because we only made one.
Thank you.
Other questions?
Yes. Had the popular vote, for, let's say, change from the 50s through 62? Because it, I think you mentioned the popular vote in the Hoff election, and it was very close. I mean, there was a fair number of Democrats.
It had been trending Democratic a little bit
beforehand.
It had been trending in that direction.
Okay.
And the book goes into some.
And then in 1964, Lyndon Johnson beats Barry Goldwater in Vermont
by a landslide.
And that also gathered more momentum.
But for Johnson to win Vermont 64 is its own its own story, because Vermont hadn't voted for a
Democrat for president.
That's right.
I don't know.
That hand went up first, and then that one.
How do you explain the occasional election of Republican governors in recent years?
Well, my view is that politics in Vermont is personal, and even though we have been a Democratic state primarily since certainly the late 80s, Republicans can still win. Jim Douglas did, because he, at least in his early campaign, of course, Douglas had run for a lot of offices and been elected for years and years, Secretary of State, Treasurer, so people were used to seeing his name on the ballot. But when he campaigned, it was all personal. It wasn't very partisan. And, you know, I was just talking to a friend of mine today. There are very few Republican leaders in the U.S. who haven't flocked to Romney, except Douglas. Frankly, I guess it's hard to say, he never liked him when he was governor of Massachusetts. And he has stayed, for him, who spent his whole career in public life, he's been quiet as a church mouse on this election.
You know, I was in the legislature in the 80s when Dick Snelling, a Republican, was governor. And I guess two things about this. I've got one theory that we have, since Phil Hoff, if I'm right, I think I'm right about this, we have alternated Democrat and Republican every single time since Phil Hoff. Mm. One theory I have about it is that it's activism followed by a breather. Activism followed by a breather. And along the way, the Republicans, if you look at Dean Davis, who's a revered figure in Vermont following Phil Hoff, and Dick Snelling, who was the governor, the Republican governor after that, with Tom Sandman in between, were both actually very, moderate's not the right term. Well, moderate's a term that certainly applies. They were not ideologues.
Right.
And Snelling, when Dick Snelling was governor, when I was in the legislature, legislation was typically passed by the more moderate Republicans and the Democrats. It was never passed, not never, but most major things that went through required that coalition, because actually Dick Snelling was not always that popular with a lot of Republicans in the legislature during that time. Although because of his business connections, he had the Republican base overall. But his problem actually, because he was moderate, and because there was always a commitment to, if you will, the sort of social contract, such as it is, the way it plays out in Vermont, the problem was within the party, not, and it always required that coalition to make things happen. So there was another one, yes.
Yeah, I was just curious, what role, if any, do you think that the economy in the state contributed to this transformation?
No question, in the 1960s, Vermont woke up, and it was a strong, from an economic position, compared to what it was, very strong. IBM gets created. More and more businesses. And it was very robust. And Phil Hoff was very, in his early term, very, in a very pro-business, too. And that helped propel the change in the state.
You know, one of the things that Hoff was furious at the Republicans. One of the reasons he was so furious at the Republicans for defeating his plan to import hydroelectric power from Quebec was that he said it would have given, guaranteed, for 40 years, Vermont would have the lowest energy rates in all of New England, which would have attracted, you know, much more business and many more jobs. And Steve, who, of course, has spent much of his life in the energy business, could tell you whether that would have worked or not.
Well, I think it did, because finally when Vermont did start buying power from Quebec, from Hydro Quebec in the 80s, our rates in Vermont went from the highest in New England to the lowest.
Yeah, and speaking of the economy, you also have to, if you go, I've heard Phil talk about during that time he was going out with Jonah from the Northeast Kingdom, it's impossible for us today to imagine the poverty that he encountered. You know, I don't know what the right numbers are, but many, if not most, houses with no window plumbing, very isolated, real poverty. So that's part of what Phil inherited, and that's part of what drove him, especially to be a pro-business in those early years. So yes, you've been waiting.
Could you talk a little bit about the changing demography of the state and what role that played? You talked about the guys who came back from the war, and you talked about the old farmers kind of getting reapportioned out of the legislature, but what about the complexion of the electorate?
That's a great question.
Great question,
yeah.
Well, in the 1960s, in the decade of the 60s, our population grew 14%. in the decade of the 70s, another 14%. And those were all a lot of new Vermonters. We started then to get some of our folks who had come to Vermont to college. Some of them were starting to stay, and they were starting businesses. We then, for basically the 90s and 2000, we've had a flat population. So we have become older again, I mean, as a cohort. And economic opportunity for young Vermonters is still a real challenge. I know in my own family, it's hard to keep your children here still, even though Vermont is much more prosperous than we ever were. But we are still finding it difficult. So now you see the candidates for public office, whether it was Douglas and certainly even and Howard Dean. They're always talking about trying to keep young Vermonters here. And that is a constant theme that I'm afraid has not yet, we haven't found the answer.
Just to pick up on that question, I think he was also wanting to know whether the demographic changes happening in the 50s that made it possible beyond the politics of the movement for somebody like Phil Hoff to emerge.
Well, there weren't, there were certainly more people starting to come into Vermont, and they tended to be post-war a little bit younger. So I think there was, but they still voted Republican. That hadn't changed then. But their children were the real vanguards of that change.
I would think that the farm population, which is largely Republican, lost more children, right, than the whole population overall in Vermont.
Lost more children.
Right.
I think you're
in
right.
In terms of out-migration.
Exactly.
And that started, going to that the earlier question, that started long before Phil Hoff in 1960. Yeah. As the number of farms went down. Yes.
Has Vermont always had a 2-year term for governor, and how has that played into the
political field? Yes. It has. There have been attempts over the years to change it. It requires a constitutional amendment. It passed the legislature in the 70s or early 80s. I can't remember. It was before, actually, in the 70s, the first time.
Went
down in flames. And I my sense is it will continue to go down in flames.
Only Vermont and New Hampshire are now the only two states left. And actually, Governor Shumlin argues against a 4-year term.
There's a lot of, I'm actually remain in favor, so I'm violating my own rule. I remain in favor of a 2-year term as well. Because we're such a small state, it's very personal. It keeps people in the legislature or the governor's office, all of which is 2-year terms, very close to the people. And that we are a Republican, I don't mean Republican Party, a Republican form of government, where the legislators in the end, after touching business, make the decisions. If a state, the further you go, if you go to a 4-year term, this is the one argument on the one side. A 4-year term removes government a little bit from the people, and that's when states sometimes then end up with referenda and the chaos that comes with that. So I think I'm just giving the one argument. The other argument is, and this is the argument Phil Hoff would make and has, the other argument is that you just, it hampers your ability to be an effective governor, because the minute you're elected, you're right on the reelection cycle. And so those are the two arguments back and forth that have been going on for a long time. It's taken up in the legislature in one form or another, depending on how far it gets, almost every year. And it doesn't tend to get very far. So, yes.
Don't you think it's also true that if you run for 4 years or 6 years, the minute you're elected, you're running again? I mean, the night you sworn into office, you had your first fundraiser for the next election, 6 years away.
Unless you have a term limit.
Pardon?
Unless you have a term limit.
Well, we don't have term limits.
No.
No. And incidentally, Vermont has not defeated an incumbent governor since Ray Keyser lost to Phil Hoff in 1962. March.
You mentioned keeping our young people in Vermont, which I think to me is a big issue. And there's something about Vermont has its own character, and that is rural and beautiful and everything we all love. But we're not able to keep our young people here. They have to go off to get jobs. Is Vermont, the legislature, recognizing this? Do they have any plans to come up with keeping young people here? And if so, what are they?
You know, that's getting maybe a little bit closer to politics than we want to get tonight.
When
this discussion comes up, I always start it with at least saying, let's recognize that it's been happening since the Civil War.
It's not a new phenomenon. All right.
It is, of course, discussed in the legislature constantly, and you can make arguments on both all over the place on this.
But if we do something, then that would probably change the character of Vermont.
Well, I don't think anybody would argue for the worse, because
it seem like it might do that? Change the character of Vermont? What brings other people in?
Of course, I think everybody universally thinks it would be great if there were more opportunities for young people.
Yes.
In Vermont, and they could stay. I think that's about 100%.
Right.
And the question is how you do it, but that's a topic for another day.
I don't.
You in the back?
I'm here to learn about my new state, and this has been very interesting. Just a comment, there was talk about both Sweden and Volvo tonight. I worked for Volvo for 25 years. I lived in Sweden twice, and I can pretty well guarantee you that Vermont is still whiter than Sweden because of the immigration to Sweden from...
Thank you for that.
Yes.
And last political
question.
It has to do with the current senator, Simon's. Could you just elaborate very little bit about why he went from the Democratic Party to the Independent Party?
Are you talking about Jim Jeffers or Bernie Sanders?
Bernie Sanders.
Well, I'll let you go ahead.
Well, first of all, Bernie Sanders was never a Democrat. I mean, he has always said that he's in. Well, actually, at first he said he was a socialist. Then he said, well, no, I'm an independent who caucuses with the Democrats. Yeah. And Vermont has, remember, he started running for office in 1972. And it wasn't until 1990 when he was elected by 10 votes as mayor of Burlington that he did start on this rise. And now he's incredibly revered politician in this state who is, one of the interesting things about him, he's never once run a negative campaign or a negative ad in his whole political career, which is very interesting. And he gathers strength in the places you would not expect. He speaks with a Brooklyn accent. But when he goes in the Northeast Kingdom, he walks on water, frankly. And more he's become a spokesperson for the person who is independent and is not controlled by either party.
So we have time for one more because I think we're 8:30, so I believe is the rule, right?
Yes.
So, okay, one more.
I just want to go back to the demographics question again. I want to know about party enrollment, because if Vermont went from red to blue, has enrollment changed substantially now? Vermont apparently at one point was predominantly a Republican state, does that mean enrollment now is predominantly Democrat?
The quick answer to that is we don't know.
Right.
Because we don't enroll by, there's no party registration in Vermont.
Right. We have legal voters, not registered.
Yeah, you're just a voter. Nobody knows whether you're Republican or Democrat directly when you go into
and
the.
It's always been that way.
Always been that way.
Right.
Yeah. There is the old story, we'll close with this, about the, back in the days when it was all Republican, the story is that, of course, if there was a Democrat in town, he or she was well known, and the election takes place, and typically there had been the one Democratic vote, and they all knew who it was. And a year came along when there were two votes in the town, and the clerks looked at each other and said, the bastard voted twice.